Yeah, you're ready.
You might want to like open your book and just throwing out ideas. Okay, so 9-7, put your phones away. I'll be fast. Give me 25 minutes. Okay, so the last section is final integration techniques. Okay, so this is like nothing brand new. It's just using algebraic ideas to do integration. Okay, so for question number one, we have a quotient. Okay, so we have a fraction with an integral. So what are the things that you look for? What do you try? Okay, so we see if we can simplify. Can we simplify this in any way? You can factor the bottom. What would it factor into? X plus 1 squared. Okay, so is that going to get us anywhere, though? Not as it is. Not yet. Is it an arc sine? No, there's no square root. Is it an arctangent? No, because we have three terms. Nothing is perfect squared. So is it a rule number four? Okay, so think about rule number four. Okay, number four is the top the derivative of the bottom? Okay, so if I think about the bottom would be, let's call it u. What is the derivative? Okay, so is that the same as the top? Is it kind of close? Sort of, kind of. Okay, so this is what we're going to do, is we are going to turn it into what we want it to. Okay, so it's missing the plus 2. Okay, so this is going to be a little bit of algebra. If I add 2 to something, what do I have to do to undo it? Subtract 2. Okay, so I'm going to make it the way I want it to be, and then I'm going to separate it into two separate integrals. Okay, so if I separate this, this is now going to become the one that I want, x squared plus 2 on the top over the bottom, minus what's left over, so the 2 over the x squared plus 2x plus 1. Okay, so now if I integrate the first one, that's my basic rule number 4, it's going to be literally what? So it's just straightforward, the natural log of the absolute value of the bottom piece. Okay, now let's see what we can do the second one. Okay, the second one just has a 2 on the top. So this one is a little bit harder to see, and what I'm going to do with this one is I'm going to do what Matt said. I'm going to factor the bottom and see if you see what happens after I factor it. Okay, so it becomes x plus 1, as you said, squared. Okay, so anytime I have a quantity with an exponent, what should I be thinking about? What rule was it probably going to be? It's usually
the general power.
The general power or the u substitution rule, right? Okay, so let's think about u substitution in this case. Hold on, let me use a different color. Okay, so on the second integral, the u is the piece in the parentheses. It'll be x plus 1. So what's the derivative of x plus 1? 1. Okay, so now if I compare that...
Attention sophomores with the last name beginning I through K, please report to the computer lab to register for your classes. Thank you.
If I compare 1 to the top 2, are they the same? Close. How do I make 2 turn into 1? Divide by 2. Okay, so then in the front, you're going to have a 2.
To
make it 1. Yeah, I want it to be what the derivative is. So now I can rewrite it in terms of u, and I'm going to ignore my natural log piece just for a second here. So it's going to turn into u to the negative 2 du. Everybody follow that substitution? So I just pulled my quantity upstairs and replaced the the 1 dx with a du. And now I can do basic integration. So what's the integral of u to the negative 2? U to the negative 1 over negative 1. Okay. So I'm going to write this all now in blue. So I'm going to include my natural log piece, pull it down. Okay, so I'm going to have, since I have minus and then I have a negative in the bottom, everybody follow, that's going to turn into a plus 2. And then I'm going to replace my u with x plus 1. And since it has a negative exponent, I'm going to put it down into the denominator. Plus c. How do we do on that? Everybody follow those steps? I think that is probably like the hardest one to see.
That one is really rough.
So I think at this point, if you understand what happens, that's good enough for now. Yeah, that was pretty magical, right? Okay, so let's try number 2. We're going to do kind of the same idea for number 2. Okay, so again, I'm going to be thinking about rule number 14. Okay, so if I look at the bottom and compare it to the top, what is the derivative of the bottom? E to the x. So is e to the x the top? No. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to add e to the x to the top, which means what do I have to do to undo that? We can multiply it. Do you want to multiply it?
That would be easier. Then it would be 1 over e to the x.
You actually can do both ways. Yep.
Let's
e to the x.
Multiplying.
Okay, so if we do this, the rewrite is going to be e to the x. I don't know why I feel like I have to write this in front. dx. Okay, so if I write it like this, the next step is I want to separate it into two different integrals, right? Or two different fractions, kind of. Okay, so it'll be the integral of 1 over e to the x times the piece I want it to be. Let's see how this plays out. I didn't do it this way, so I'm not sure how. You're lost. The reason I did that is because the idea is I wanted to use the rule number 14, right?
Would it have mattered which numerator?
No. But if I went the other way and pulled the e, then I would just be back to where I started. Yeah, but 1 over e to the x has a variable in it. Okay. I think that what I'm going to do, I'm going to have to go back and figure out how this way would work. You can do it this way, but I don't see how it works at this point. So if that's okay with you, I'm going to go back and just add my e to the x and subtract it, because I can see how that one works, and then I'll show you later. Sorry.
I still don't get why you're bad.
Oh, okay, I'll show you. So, this is hard to see. Okay, so if I separate this, this can separate into 1 plus... What? Okay, so I'm adding e to the x and subtracting e to the x because the derivative of the bottom was e to the x. So I'll show you what happens. So I have e to the x plus 1 minus e to the x over e to the x plus 1. So do you see that separation?
So that's a du, that's rule number 4, and that's 1.
Yeah, it just simplifies into 1. Because if you add something, you have to subtract it. It's just another thing you can do. So it is possible for you to multiply by e to the x and divide by e to the x, but I didn't see that. I have to go back and look at it to figure it out. So, I have, I just grouped it, so I pulled it away. So I wanted there to be an e to the x over an e to the x plus 1, so I can use the rule number 14.
Yeah.
Right? So I see that, and then basically the other one is what's left over. Okay, so it turned into this piece right here. So this piece is this. Okay, so this turned out really nice because you have the same thing over the other same, right?
Why do you mind?
Because it says minus. What?
This minus? Why did I put this minus here?
Oh, the other. Because I added e to the x, and so I have to subtract it. I have to keep it balanced. Okay, so this turns into 1. I'm going to leave this as is because I'll just integrate all at once in the next step. Okay, so what's the integral of 1?
X.
And then what's my integral of the second one? Natural log of e to the x plus 1. So this method definitely takes practice. Okay, so we can go through and do some more practicing of this. I think it will be really rare for you to see this on a test. So hopefully you won't have to completely master it. Okay, so the next example, they give you this little hint, and we started doing this in the last chapter. I think it was Hunter that threw out this idea in the last class, where if you use Pythagorean theorems, sometimes it makes it easier to integrate. Okay, so for example, we have a tangent squared and a cotangent. Does anybody know the integral of tangent squared off the top of their head? Hi.
So,
oh, sure.
The integral of it?
Integral tangent squared.
The integral? Where are you looking?
It's not on there.
Oh, so yeah, so what they're doing is they're using the Pythagorean identity to rewrite it. Okay, so we could integrate tangent squared, but we'd have to do a general power rule because it's basically tangent squared and integrate it that way. But if we replace it with the secant squared minus 1, what's the integral of secant squared?
Tangent.
That one is like straightforward. There's no more like hard integration steps that you have to do. It's going to be a literal step. So the idea is if we replace tangent squared with its identity, so I'm looking up here.
Oh, it's easier to integrate.
Yeah, it just is easier. Okay, so tangent squared is equal to secant squared plus 1, so we can say we have secant squared of 2x minus 1. And then what's cotangent squared equal to? Cosecant. And you see why we would want to do a cosecant squared? Okay, because if you look at rule number 8, it's a literal integration.
So we have 2 tangents, 2x.
Yeah, okay, so I'm going to simplify this real quick before we do this. So I would say we have the secant squared of 2x plus the cosecant squared of 3x. And so I see that we have negative 1 minus 1, which makes negative 2. And now I will integrate it. So what's the integral of secant squared? Tangent. Okay, so remember that you're integrating of 2x. We have to divide by the derivative of 2x.
Wait, wait, I have to step from 1 to 2.
Oh, I just combined the 1s together. I just combined the constants. So it'll be tan of 2x divided by 2, dividing by the derivative of 2x. What's the integral of cosecant squared? Negative, so I should say minus cotangent, whoops, not squared, excuse me, 3x divided by 3, good. And integral of 2 is 2x plus c, good. How do we do on that one? That one's not too bad. So,
really involved.
The first two questions, I completely agree, they are hard. I'm not going to sugarcoat that in any way. It is hard. Okay, so example 4 basically takes us through setting up absolute value. Okay, you guys know that you can't integrate absolute value as it's written. Hopefully you know that. If you didn't know that, now you know that. So what we're going to do is we're going to draw the absolute value of x squared minus 6. They've given us the positive, just plain old x squared minus x minus 6. So if we put an absolute value around a function, what happens graphically?
Everything below the
x-axis. Right. Okay, so it just is reflected. So the absolute value is going to be this graph, and then this is reflected, and it goes up. Okay, so what we're looking for between negative 3, so they bind this region, and 5 over here. So we're looking at the area bounded between the x-axis and that function. Okay, so what we basically have to do is we have to separate each little area out and write an integral for each of them.
Oh boy.
Okay, so let's start with this furthest one on the left. Okay, so first of all, what two x values does that lie between?
Negative 3
and negative 2, right? Okay, and that's part of the upward parabola. So that's just x squared minus x minus 6, so dx. Okay, the second piece I'm going to look at is now the upside down parabola. See where I'm looking?
So you have to throw a negative in there.
The only time you put negative is if the area exists below the x-axis. So we're just going to say plus.
A negative for the function.
Oh, yes, sorry. Yes. Okay, so between what two values? Two x values. Between negative 2 and 3. Okay, so how do we create the upside down parabola? We just put a negative in front. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a negative in front and distribute it through the whole x squared minus x minus 6. So if I distribute the negative, it becomes negative x squared plus x plus 6. So that's the upside down red part, dx. Okay, that makes sense on that one? Okay, and then the last one, the third little area, what two x values does that exist between? 3 and 5, and that's part of the up parabola. So I'm just going to say x squared minus x minus 6 for that. Okay, so that's just set up. We're going to call it quits at that point. Does that make sense for everybody? Setting up absolute value pieces? You have to separate it out.
On the test, do we have to set up absolute value?
I will answer that question at the end of class today. I'll take a look at it. I can't remember.
That's a lot of math.
I remember doing a question, but I can't remember if I did it on the review or if I did it on the test. So I'll go back and look. And they might even give you like a linear piece, like a linear one, so you can just do it with triangles. I think that might be what they do. But I'm not 100%. Okay, I'm going to do two more questions with you. Okay, so these ones I'm going to go fast because I told Jarrett that I was only going to talk for 25 minutes, even though he cheated and is already on his phone. Yeah, that gives me 10 more minutes.
You only have 12.
Oh, perfect. 5 minutes. Okay. So how do I do this one? This is just, let's do this. We're using all of the stuff that we know, everything we've learned. How are you going to do it?
General power.
Let's separate it.
Separate.
Good plan. Okay, so we're going to do the sine of e to the negative 3x over e to the 3x. Now I have minus e to the x over e to the 3x, so I'm subtracting those exponents. What's my new term? E to the negative 2x. Perfect. Okay, always simplify if you can. I can go like this and be a little lazy and do it that way, or I can write two integrals, whatever floats your boat. Okay, now we're integrating sine, right? Okay, so this is just going to be our 6u one. So what's the integral of sine?
Cosine.
Yep, so all I'm doing on this one is I'm going to do, it's basically a general power rule. I'm going to ignore the e to the 3x and hope that it cancels out. So you get the cosine of e to the negative 3x. It's over. No, it's... No, yeah, you're right. Yes, thank you. 3x. And then I have to divide by the derivative of e to the negative 3x. So what's the derivative of e to the negative 3x? Okay, good. So negative 3e to the negative 3x. So do my e's cancel out? If I have e to the 3x times e to the negative 3x.
Wait, that's negative.
Integral. Integral of sine. So yes, they cancel out. So I have a negative over a negative. I'm going to call that positive 1/3 cosine of e to the negative 3x. Because if you add exponents, they're both on the bottom, so you can add the exponents together, and they become zero. Okay, I forgot about my e to the negative 2. What's the integral of e to the negative 2?
Plus e to the u.
Nice. So I threw the steps out that Alex was doing in his head, so hopefully that made sense. Okay, next problem. We got 2 minutes. Okay, what's this one? This one is, I'm just going to tell you since we're
going
to... General power rule. Okay,
yes.
So my u... I'm going to write this out, though, even though Alex does it in his head. My u piece is the piece that's inside the parentheses with the exponent.
Natural log of sine.
Sine of x. The natural log. So what's the derivative of the natural log?
1 over... Oh, wait, no.
So if it's of u, it's going to be the derivative of u over u. So my u is sine. What's the derivative of sine?
Cosine.
Cosine. So I got cosine over sine. So now I'm looking back. Is the stuff that's on the outside the same as my derivative? It is. Awesome. So I can quickly rewrite this. So this is just going to be u squared du. Whoops, that was not a u. Okay, so that's a substitution. I'm going to integrate u squared, which is...
Wait, did we divide?
Yeah, divide the u. Yeah, it kind of is, because you have to get rid of the hook-on factor. U cubed, right? So we get 1/3 times the natural log of the sine of x. Oops, I forgot my x.
Bam.
Said it. Didn't write it. Yep, plus C. Done. Okay, so you guys need to do 1 through 12.